To begin talking about acids and bases in more detail, it is helpful to cover the definitions of acids and bases that we cover. In first semester chemistry, Chem 150 or 151, you talked about the Arrhenius theory, whether it was described by name or not. This was the theory of acids and bases that you worked with there. In this theory, acids are substances that produce hydrogen ions when they dissociate in water. Classic example, of course, is hydrochloric acid. And so because it contains a hydrogen ion, when it dissociates in water, it will produce a hydrogen ion in water. Quick side note here, when we work with the hydrogen ion in water, we often refer to it as a proton. And the reason for that is because of the nuclear notation for it. So remember that this number on bottom is the atomic number, identifying how many protons. And remember this number up top is the mass number, which is the number of protons plus neutrons. So for a hydrogen ion, since it only has a value of one, it means there is no neutron in here. That one comes from just the proton. And of course, this charge of a plus one means that this ion lost its electron. So there's no neutron, there's no electron. It is literally just a proton floating around in water. So again, the hydrogen ion we will often refer to as a proton. Again, in our Arrhenius theory, bases are substances that produce hydroxide ions in water, something like sodium hydroxide. It has the hydroxide ion in it, and so when that dissociates in water, we get pure hydroxide floating around. However, for this semester in Chem 152, we're going to use what's called the Bronsted-Lowry theory. In this theory, acids are defined as substances that can donate an H+. That means that an acid still has to contain the proton in it. And so in other words, HCl is classified as both an Arrhenius acid and a Bronsted-Lowry acid. It meets both definitions. The difference this semester is with our bases. We define bases as a substance that will accept a hydrogen ion. And so as we describe acid-base reactions, we're describing the transfer of a hydrogen ion from one reactant to another. And so notice with our Bronsted-Lowry theory that sodium hydroxide would only be considered an Arrhenius base. It is not a Bronsted-Lowry base. Sodium hydroxide does not accept an H+. So as an example of a Bronsted-Lowry acid-base reaction, we're going to work with this one. So we want to identify the acid and base in the equation below. We have the reaction of hydrochloric acid with ammonia forming the ammonium ion and chloride ion. Recognize in order to get to those products, the hydrogen from hydrochloric acid had to be donated to ammonia. Since that is donating the hydrogen, HCl, of course we already knew this, but HCl is our acid. Since ammonia is accepting that hydrogen ion, ammonia is our base. So again, we're looking at the transfer of hydrogen ions from one reactant to another. We have to have an acid reacting with a base. If we look at the reactions of acids in water and bases in water, we can still identify and label every substance as an acid or a base. So we're going to write the equation for HCl reacting in water. And I will apologize, I have a hard time writing AQs. So this physical state here, a little blurry, but that is my AQ. So HCl reacting in water. Now we know HCl is the acid, so HCl is going to donate its proton to water. That's going to leave us with the chloride ion. So pay attention to charges as you're adding or removing the H+. So again, remember H+ carries that charge with it. So if I remove the H+, I'm left just with the minus charge on chloride. Same idea, when the H plus transfers to water, it's going to change the count of my hydrogens, but it's also going to change the charge of that. And hopefully you remember the H3O plus ion is referred to as the hydronium ion. Now, other terms that we define in here, I'm going to erase this arrow, because the other terms that we define are what happens if this reaction goes in the reverse direction. Remember in chapter 13, we were describing reactions happening in both directions. Moving forward, we'll define that this one doesn't. We'll get into that and describe it. But for now, let's pretend it does go in both directions. So we already know that HCl is our acid because it donated the proton. Water, therefore, has to be the base. But if this reaction is going to go in the reverse direction, it means that my products also act as acids and bases. I can't call them acid and base, though, because these would be substances that I would actually grab from the reagent shelf. The ones on the product side are simply products of the reaction. So if this reaction is going to happen in the reverse, realize first of all that chloride can't be an acid. It doesn't have a proton attached to it. And that means, therefore, my hydronium ion would be the acid on the product side. For the substances on our product side, since they're not pure acids and bases, we call them conjugates. So hydronium is my conjugate acid, and chloride would be my conjugate base. And realize that that gives us acid-base pairs everywhere. Notice that HCl and chloride are a conjugate acid-base pair. By removing the H plus from HCl, I'm left with its conjugate base. Water and hydronium also form a conjugate acid-base pair. By adding a hydrogen to water, I form its conjugate acid. So let's try one more. Let's look at the reaction of ammonia in water. Ammonia, we know, is NH3. Remember, it has the familiar name. We don't use its IUPAC formal name. This one will set up equilibrium, again, for reasons we'll get into as we go through this chapter. And now what we have to recognize is, of course, starting by figuring out which one's going to be the acid and which one's going to be the base. Hopefully, we remember that ammonia is a base. And so that helps to label that one. So if ammonia is the base, water has to be the acid. That means that water is donating its proton to ammonia. And so my conjugate acid of ammonia is going to be the ammonium ion, one of our only positively charged polyprotic acids or cations. And so once water donates its proton, we're going to be left with hydroxide. Therefore, our ammonium ion is the conjugate acid of ammonia. Again, we have a conjugate acid base pair. Our hydroxide is the conjugate base of water. And again, that's because we have a conjugate acid base pair here. Great practice for you that I'll recommend you work is to do the same thing with these equations. To first of all predict the products for each one, and then label and identify the acid, the base, the conjugate acid, and conjugate base. And the answers are left in the slides for you to work on. And the last thing that we work on this slide is the shortcut version of conjugate acids and bases. So as we go through this chapter and the next one, very often I will ask you, what is the conjugate base of a substance? What is the conjugate acid of a substance? So realize if I'm asking for the conjugate base of a formula, that means that this substance is acting as an acid. So if I want to find its conjugate base, that means I need to remove the H plus. Anytime we're asking or asked to find the conjugate base, we want to remove the H plus from a substance, and that will give us the formula of its conjugate base. A couple of things to note here. One is that we're removing one hydrogen at a time. So recognize with sulfuric acid, its conjugate base still has one hydrogen left over, and its charge only decreased by a count of one. However, that conjugate base can now act as an acid. And so the conjugate base of hydrogen sulfate finally gives us our sulfate ion. So hydrogen sulfate is similar to water in that both of these are what we call amphoteric substances. Both of these can act as both acids and bases. On the right side of our table here, I'm asking you to identify the conjugate acid of each of these substances. So recognize if I'm looking for the conjugate acid, that means this substance is acting as a base. And so with that, we want to add a hydrogen ion to each of our substances in order to determine the formula of the conjugate base. And again, we're only adding one hydrogen at a time. So specifically note with our carbonate polyatomic ion, I'm only adding one hydrogen at a time. And so its count goes up by one. Notice that hydrogen carbonate can then also act as a base and accept another hydrogen. So hydrogen carbonate is also amphoteric.